Hello everyone, welcome back to another tutorial. Today I want to talk about the plugin Fast Async Worldedit, aka FAWE. I'm going to be covering a few brushes that I find extremely useful within this plugin. Now remember, Fast Async Worldedit is a plugin, it's not the same as the Worldedit mod, so these commands that I'm about to use may not work in your basic Worldedit mod. If you need a server that allows free use of this plugin, I will leave a great one in the description, and it's actually the one I'm on right now, Builder's Refuge. Anyways, let's get started. We're going to start off today by making some terrain. I want to use the height brush. The height brush's basic command is br height, and you can see that when you type in that, it tells you the usage. So brush height, and then your radius, your clipboard or file, your rotation, and your height or your Y scale. Basically, the height brush command uses height maps that are black and white to create blocks in game. I'll show you an example of one on screen right now. So, in the command where we put the imgur link, that is actually going to be a height map. If you're not sure where to get height maps, I'll leave a link that you can buy them in the description below. My friend Aerios actually sells some, and he's given us a promotion link for 25% off of all of his height maps, and he has quite a few, so I definitely recommend checking those out. If you want a sample of them, he's also been kind enough to leave us a free sample of his height map, so I'll leave that in the description as well. Definitely check them out. In your height brush command, when talking about the Y scale, if the Y scale is set to 1, that means the height map can go up to a height of 256 blocks. If it was set to something like 0.5, it would be half of that. I'm setting mine to around 0.7. The other flags that you can see used here are negative R, which enables random off-axis rotation, negative L, which allows you to work with snow layers and get even more advanced terrain, and then negative S, which will disable the smoothing. Our radius is going to be 50, so this is a fairly large brush. And then we've got 0.1 for our rotation and 0.7 for our Y scale. So let's get a little look at what this looks like when we click on the grass here. Yeah, that gives a really nice mountain. Now, what if I want to see what my mountain is going to look like before I click down? Because look, every time I do it, it's going to give a slightly different result. So I'm going to undo that. And now I'm going to type /br. viz2. And what this is going to do is create an outline, and you can see as I move around, this outline changes, and we can figure out where we want to go. Like maybe right here, that looks like a good mountain. Okay, I'll do that one. Now what if we move it over here? What's that going to look like? All right, we get a cool mountain range there. Let's do it. Now over here. Yeah, so I absolutely love the effect of this. If you want to get rid of that, just change the 2 to a 0, and now it will not visualize it anymore, and we get these super cool mountains here. If you accidentally bind one of these brushes to your hand, for example, let's try this. Here you go. So now this height brush is bound to my fist. If I click, I won't be able to break anything. I'll just end up placing mountains. If I want to get rid of this, all I have to do is type /none. I see a lot of people having difficulty with that, so I figured I'd bring it up. Now that we have our mountains in place, I want to move on to the surface brush. So /br surface. And there we go. It gives us the parameters. So we need pattern and radius. Now I'm actually going to do something a little bit more advanced with this and add a slightly different pattern than what you would normally would. But at first I want to just use it normally. So we're going to br surface, and our pattern will be stone and our radius will be 10. So let's just see what this does. It'll just paint the surface block. So if I go in here, you'll be able to see that there's no stone in there. So it only paints the blocks that are on the surface. Now, what if I want it to paint the blocks on the surface in a different pattern? So instead of using stone, maybe I want to use a biome. So I'm going to do #L3D and then square bracket, and now I can type in my biomes. So for example, a mesa biome and a jungle biome mixed together, maybe with a plains biome as well. Let's just throw that in there for some fun. Now I'm going to close that bracket off, and we'll still use the radius 10. Now when I paint, it's actually going to paint a biome. I'm gonna do it on the flatter part so that you guys can see. You can see it's mixing these biomes together and creating a cool color. So what if I take planes out of the equation now? So now with planes taken out of the equation, you can see we get this darker pattern. This is a really cool way to paint biomes and kind of mix them together in whichever way you would like to. If you aren't sure what biomes are available, simply do /biome list and it will list all of the available plugins for you. You can actually use biomes in pretty much any command in replacement of the ID. So for example, a regular br sphere, normally we would put an ID here, so we would put 2 or 1 or, you know, whatever block we wanted. Instead of doing that, we can actually just put a dollar sign and then a biome for the ID. And let's do a size of 5. And now if we paint, it'll paint a jungle. That is super handy. I absolutely love that. Remember, it's saying this that I'm outside of my region because it's actually trying to go below bedrock, because this is a sphere and not a surface. So keep that in mind when you're picking which brush you're going to use. Next up, I want to put some rocks in my terrain. Now, I've got a super fun command for this. We're going to play with the blob brush. So I'm going to do /br blob. Now I'm going to do a block and we'll do a size of 10. Now, if I just click around with this, you can see we're getting some different blocks around here. Now, let's see what the parameters actually are, right? So we've got a lot of parameters here. We've got the pattern, the radius, the roundness, the frequency, and the amplitude. Now, I only put in the pattern and the radius. What if we put in a roundness of 30, a frequency of 30, and an amplitude of 100? Let's see what that does. Whoa, we're getting some funky shapes. This one is a super fun one to play with. You can play with each of these numbers and get a lot of different effects. All right, so now I'm going to expand on the blob command and actually add simplex to it. So #simplex is going to randomize our blocks for us. I'm going to paste in the command. It's way easier to paste in these commands to make sure you're getting them right 100% of the time. So I'll be putting all of the commands in the description for you guys. But here is br blob simplex, and I'm actually going to change up our blocks a little. I want to use some different blocks in this. So I'm going to change our blocks to be 159.9 and 251.8. Our radius is still going to be 50, our roundness is 100, our frequency is 100, and we don't have an amplitude put in. That's okay. I'm just going to click that over here and show you guys what it makes. Isn't this so fascinating? I absolutely love this command. I mean, for terrain, that is a really cool one-click terrain. This would be so cool for some sci-fi rocks. Let me show you if we add an amplitude. Let's add an amplitude of 50. I'm gonna click right there. Whoa, we get a totally different shape again. And what about an amplitude of 100? I'll click right here. Personally, amplitude of 100 is my favorite. I just think this is so cool to play with. It gives you these amazing shapes and you could really make some cool terrain with this. So what do all of these numbers mean? Let's go over it again. We've got brush, we got brush blob, then simplex to randomize. Simplex has a scale of 10 and these are our blocks. We can add any blocks that we would like in here. This is our radius, so 50, 50, 50. Then we have our roundness, our frequency, and our amplitude, all set to 100 right now. You can change these numbers and get different effects every time. So for example, if we wanted it to be maybe way smaller this way, let's change our size. I actually bound that to my hand. There we go. And there we have it. So we get a slightly smaller and different blob. And this terrain is looking like something from outer space right now. Let's move on to the next command. The next command I would like to introduce to you guys is brush surface spline. So we're gonna type it like this, br surface spline, and it'll bring up the parameters when I type that in. So we've got pattern, size, tension, bias, continuity, and quality. So we've got a lot of different stuff to pick from here. I'm actually going to do a pattern of 168 and a size of 5, and that's the only thing I'm going to put in right now, just for demonstration purposes. So I'm going to click around here, add some different positions. You can see it keeps adding positions, and now if I click the same spot twice like that, it'll actually join them all together. You can see this is a really cool way to create different paths, maybe rivers, all throughout your terrain. All you've got to do is remember to click in the same spot. So maybe this is my last spot. There we go, we click it twice, and we have a cool path coming down our mountain. While we are on the topic of putting roads and paths onto terrain or in your world, I wanted to show you guys the brush sweep command. So I'm going to select this little roadway right here and copy it onto my clipboard. And then I'm going to use the br sweep command to paste my clipboard in a line wherever I want it to go. So I'm going to click here and then up here, and I just have to click twice. And it will create my roadway. And this is so much easier than building the entire road yourself. Definitely make use of this command, everyone. All right, guys, next we're going to begin with the brush spline command. So to start off with this, we need our selection to be a convex. So we're gonna do cell and then convex. This will allow us to select more than one position. If you want to get out of convex selection, simply type cell cuboid and you'll return to the normal selection. So now we're going to create a simple curve using up one and then the curve command. Now /curve1. You want to make sure that your line doesn't have any diagonal connections, connections like these, where the blocks aren't quite connecting, but you also don't want to have any clumps of blocks. This will confuse the spline command selection. Now that we have our two curves, we're going to create our spline brush by typing /br spline and then our block, which is 57. We can also add a radius. I'll do a radius of 100 for the demonstration. So I'm simply going to now select the ends of each of these curves. When I'm ready to join them, I click this block twice. And you can see that it perfectly joins these curves and creates a nice spline between them, connecting them perfectly. This is great for creating cloth and dragon wing. I absolutely love this command, and it can be used in a lot of different ways. If you want a more in-depth tutorial, I'll leave one link in the description. Go check it out. All right, everyone. So I have two more super important commands to show you, but I thought I would show you on an actual build. So behind me, you can see that I did the terrain with a blob command that we used earlier, and then I used the curve command that we used just a second ago to create this tree. I kind of like the effect of this, and I want to go for kind of an alien-like landscape. So I've created some leaves over here. Now we are going to be using the scatter brush to place these leaves on this tree. This is going to be super helpful because it allows me to not only use custom leaves, but also get a random rotation, a random selection of leaves put on, and the leaves are way less round compared to if you just use a normal brush that is splattering. So all I'm going to do is create a schematic folder with each of these leaves in it. So I select each one, pose one, pose two, then I'm going to copy it. Now, actually, I'm going to copy from like in here and then schem, save. I'm going to do alien tree has my folder name and then one because this is my first leaf. Now I just have to do that again for each and every leaf. All right. So now that I've got these selected, I can pick a tool to bind my brush to, and then I'm going to type the command br scatter hashtag full copy. And then we want the schematic folder. So we did the schematic folder alien tree, and we're gonna put true, and then 1, 1, 1, -O. Basically the ones are telling it to place one object one time, and the -O is for random rotation. I would like to intercept for a second. There was a small mistake made when I was making this tree in the command, and I want to make sure that I get it exactly right for this tutorial. So the exact brush scatter command that you need to use is one with full copy, then your folder, which in our case is alien tree, and then two trues. The first true is going to control your rotate. The second one is going to control the flip. So with both of these enabled, you get even more random selections. The -O enables the brush to place on top of blocks, which is what we want when we're creating a tree like this one. Now that I have my scatter brush enabled, all I'm going to do is go over to my tree and begin using the command on the ends of these branches to get the best effect. I start by placing one on the end of each branch to kind of see what the effect is going to look like, and then I add more and more as time goes on. After a lot of careful clicking with this brush, you can see the tree is really starting to come to life. I love the gradient that I gave to these leaves, and I think they suit the terrain very nicely to give a nice little alien tree. I'm not gonna go too overboard with these leaves. It doesn't have to be perfect for the purposes of a tutorial. Now I want to move on to the next command that I'd like to show you guys, which is also the last command before we start fixing up this build a little more. So, br catenary works by picking a pattern a length factor, and then a size. For my pattern, I'm going to use the gold block because it's going to stand out the most in this terrain so that you guys can see. The length factor bounces off of 1, so if I have 1, then it's going to be a perfectly straight line. 1.2, for example, gives a nice curve. And I'm not going to set a size because I just want it to be a thin line. Now, with this brush, we can simply create some really cool vines coming from this tree. So I'm going to click here, then I just have to select another point, and it will create a nice line right between them. And if I change this number to maybe be 1.1, it will be a little less of a harsh line. So let's find another spot to add a vine. Maybe right here? Let's try up here. Whoa, yeah, so that gives such a nice little gentle curve to it. I love that. So I can come between some of these branches and add a nice vine right there. There we go. Oh, I love that. Let's add some between the rocks here. Beautiful, beautiful. I mean, you can see how much this just speeds up the process of building these. So much. I'm just gonna connect all of our lovely little floating meteors all together. Alright, so now I've replaced some of our meteors going around this alien tree with gold. Now I'm going to equip my brush and type another version of the blob command with simplex. This time we're going to use a lot more different block IDs and some slightly different shapes. I'm then going to mask this to gold, which is 41. Now, when I click on my meteors, you can see I get this super cool pattern. I absolutely love the look of this, and we're going to use this to color in these rocks to be a little bit more unique. So now it's time to replace. I'm going to be replacing the emerald to be the same as before, which is the cyan terracotta. This will keep some consistency within our blocks. Now I'm going to bring some of that bright purple into our meteors. I'm going to replace the sponge with 9510. And finally, with this last replace, we get the full effect of our meteors, now with that beautiful purple glow because of the simplex command. I absolutely love this effect. It definitely gives them a lot more of that magic. It looks like it's got some of those cool crevices in throughout the rocks, and there's definitely a certain sense of power throughout this build, which was done mostly with brushes. All right, everyone, that is all for me. I hope you enjoyed this brushes tutorial for Fast Async Worldedit. I had a lot of fun making it. There are so many useful commands in Fast Async Worldedit. Let me know if you want me to cover more of them, because I certainly did not cover even half of the brushes that are available to us. Anyways, I will see you guys in the next tutorial. Bye-bye!